adorned their bodies and homes. They sought out items that would attract the admiration of their peers.
In some societies, the rulers maintained a large part of their prestige and esteem by controlling the trade in prestige goods coming in from outside, and they could then bestow these on their retinue, who would therefore be of very high prestige. So they were able to enhance their power by controlling the trade, particularly in valuables and high prestige goods.
And often they came from far away, so they also spoke about and symbolized the way in which locally important people were in some kind of distant diplomatic or some other sort of political relationship with distant powerful figures.
The story of the Silk Road is one of transcontinental trade in the ancient world. It's also fascinating to realize that it was China that first sent explorers west to discover new cultures and to trade. In the past, historians thought that the great civilization of China developed with little or no contact with Western cultures. Between China and India lies the virtually impassable barrier of the Himalayan mountains. Further north lies the ferociously hostile environment of the desert of Taklimakan. The temperature in this desert can reach over 50 degrees Celsius. So arid is it, a local people named it the Land of Death. The Taklimakan is flanked by high mountains both to the north and to the south. Even so, ancient traders found a way through. Along its southern and northern fringes, there are a series of oases. These oases were the key to one of the most famed of all ancient trade routes, the Silk Road.
For centuries before the conquest of the Arabs in 751, this was the basic link between East and West, and traders of every nationality from central Iran moved eastwards primarily to get hold of silk, but also other goods. And the Chinese were interested in getting people, musicians, dancing girls, and certain kinds of spices by this route.
This route made famous the names of Tashkent and Samarkand. The route was never a single road, but several pathways that changed over time to accommodate new political boundaries or to avoid bandits. Contrary to popular myth, it was not Marco Polo who first used the Silk Road to discover China. In fact, it was China that, long before him, first sent emissaries to the West. The birth of the route was the product of difficult times. During the Han Dynasty, the Chinese were under attack from the Xiongnu people. Emperor Wudi decided to send Zhuang Can west to try to gain an alliance against the Xiongnu. On his dangerous journey, Zhuang Can was captured and thrown into jail. He never made the alliance he was sent for, but eventually he returned home with something far more valuable. He'd seen marvelous horses that were larger than those available in China at the time.
Horses do not breed well in China. It's too wet and too hot. But to fight the nomads on horseback, they needed horses. So for centuries, they would trade with the nomads with bales of silk. These bales of silk made their way westwards and became what we know as the Silk Route trade.
It didn't take the Chinese long to realize that they had a wonderful product to trade. Silk became hugely valued, especially as its only source was China. The Chinese had perfected its production several millennia ago.
Manufacture of silk is very sophisticated in its way. It involves taking a cocoon and unraveling the silk so that it can be used as an incredibly fine material for making cloth.
It has, like all Chinese crafts, to be done on an enormous scale. You have to think of millions of worms being turned into silk cloth. Only the Chinese did this, and of course this beautiful cloth had a sheen and would take lovely coloured dyes, and these colours made silk even more alluring.
And of course silk was a very highly prized and valuable commodity for centuries, for millennia. And we can see that silk as a luxury good was traded a very long way into the steppe lands of Eurasia, and various different traders and merchants would pass on this silk till it arrived in Rome.
In the West, in time, the Roman Empire emerged as the dominant power. The Romans first encountered Chinese silk on campaign against the Parthians. Understandably, they were deeply impressed by the beauty and texture of the material. Silk soon became fashionable in Rome. The Parthians quickly realized there was a lucrative trade to be had in bringing the silk west.
Trade by way of middlemen through the Parthian and Persian empires, who straddled the trade routes, was very ancient and was continuing, for example, throughout the time of the Roman Empire and the Han dynasty in China. These two great states never exchanged diplomatic embassies or made any formal political contact, but they did exchange enormous amounts of silk and other luxury goods, of gold and silver coinage, which flowed via the Persian civilization in the middle.
The Romans knew silk was not made by the Parthians. It wasn't long before they sent their own agents east to find the source of silk. The Romans found that the Chinese would not easily part with the secret of silk.
The silk route, which took silk from China to the West, was economically very important to the Chinese state. And because they had the monopoly on silk, they very jealously guarded it. So, for example, it's said that there was a death penalty for anybody who smuggled the silkworm out of China.
I mean, one of the things about trade, obviously, is that you don't want other potential rivals to know your sources, if possible. You want to keep it secret where it's coming from and how it's made and all these kinds of things. And, of course, you can see it today. I mean, we have all kinds of corporate espionage now, which is really just an elaboration of what's been going on throughout history.
Despite the intentions of the West, the secret of silk remained in Chinese hands for centuries.
In the 6th century, about 550 AD, the Byzantine emperor managed to get his hands on some silkworms that were allegedly smuggled out of China by some monks who had put them in hollow staffs.
And eventually, in the Roman West, or the Byzantine West, silk industries were established, and silk was woven in Western Europe at Lyon, but never, ever was it made on the scale that is made in China.
As the demand for luxuries grew, so too did the particular wants of the buyer. The consumer was born. As trade routes developed, gold, ivory, gems, and glass headed east to be traded for silk, furs, ceramics, lacquer, and iron. Where gold was the most highly valued commodity in the West, in the East, jade was considered far more precious. It would be intriguing to know at what rate Western gold was exchanged for Eastern jade.
Jade doesn't come all over China. It's found in two areas in what we would call the Neolithic period, that is, pre the use of metal. It occurs around Shanghai and in the far north, north of Peking. And that is significant because it means that Chinese don't get into gold. That whereas our cultures are based on gold and light, we have huge numbers of metaphors about the role of spirituality, which is related metaphorically to gold and light. In China, that is missing because they didn't get into gold. They got into jade.
Interestingly, China was not the only civilization that valued jade more highly than gold. When the Spaniards conquered the Aztec Empire, their lust for gold was insatiable. This led many scholars to assume that it was the most highly prized material in ancient Central America. The Aztecs had many gold objects which were melted down by the Spanish conquistadors, but many jade objects survived. Jade was also more highly valued than gold by the more ancient civilizations of Mexico, which the Aztecs had brutally suppressed. In the Olmec era, which lasted from about 1450 BC to 100 BC, many remarkable and very lifelike figures were made of serpentine and jade. Most Olmec objects are made from blue-green jade, but a few are of the transparent dark green jade, which is so highly prized in China. For the Olmecs, jade was not just a precious stone, but also a symbol for the heart of the earth. Their cult of Earth God led them to bury many jade objects as soon as they were made, which is why so many have been so well preserved. Other cultures in Central America used jade for axes, chisels, and weapons, but the Olmecs seem to have used their jade mainly for objects of art and devotion. These were widely traded around the large area that is now Mexico. The two main thrusts of Olmec expansion across Mexico to the northwest and towards Guatemala to the southeast can be explained by the need to guarantee their supplies of jade. It's possible that the continued fondness of native peoples for jade, serpentine and turquoise may have reduced their opposition to the Spanish removal of gold. Over and again, new discoveries have pushed back the date of the start of trading. Furthermore, trade routes have been shown to be more extensive and complex than previously thought. As the voyage of discovery continues, more and more information about our past is being uncovered. But scholars know that each new find raises as many questions as it answers. The search for the marvelous